year is 1917, and Representative Oscar Calloway enters a disturbing statement into the U.S. congressional record. The statement reveals why J.P. Morgan interests hired 12 high-ranking news managers. The 12 were asked to determine the most influential newspapers in America. They were to figure out how many news organizations it would take to control generally the policy of the daily press of the United States. The 12 found it was only necessary to purchase the control of 25 of the greatest papers. An agreement was reached. The policy of the papers was bought, and an editor was placed at each paper to ensure that all published information was in keeping with the new policy. Soon, that policy would be defined by a front group formed by J.P. Morgan and his colleagues. In fact, Morgan's personal attorney was founding president of the organization, the Council on Foreign Relations. Today, the CFR maintains that its goal is to increase America's understanding of the world. However, the actual objective of this highly exclusive club is revealed by the rare admissions of the insiders themselves. In the early 60s, a Georgetown University professor collects information for a book favorable to the network of powerful men who founded the CFR. For 2 years, Professor Carol Quigley is allowed to examine the confidential papers and secret records of this network. Quigley reveals that these men aim to create a world system of financial control in private hands, able to dominate the political system of each country and the economy of the world as a whole. In short, they seek total and quiet control of the entire world. And the CFR is their most visible conduit for carrying out that agenda. CFR members include America's wealthiest tycoons, as well as the highly placed elite in government, academic institutions, tax-exempt foundations, and the establishment media. Ruling Class Journalists, written by Richard Harwood, describes the CFR membership as the ruling establishment in the United States. The Washington Post article boasted that news reporters who are CFR members do not merely analyze and interpret foreign policy for the United States, they help make it. Who are these policymakers? Many of their faces are familiar. NBC's Tom Brokaw, CBS's Dan Rather, ABC's Barbara Walters, Jim Lehrer of PBS, William F. Buckley of National Review, media mogul Rupert Murdoch, owner of the giant multifaceted News Corporation. These media heavyweights, and many others like them, are members of the CFR. Powerful corporations are also invited to become members. At the close of the 20th century, CFR influence presided over far-reaching consolidations of media control. In 1995, CFR members Michael Eisner of Disney and ABC's Thomas Murphy merged their media empires. Soon after the merger, the Disney-ABC empire becomes a CFR corporate member. In the year 2000, the world's largest internet service provider, America Online, joins forces with Time Warner, one of the world's largest news organizations. The CEOs favoring the move are CNN's Thomas Johnson and Time Warner's Gerald Levin, both CFR members. Once again, another media giant is created under the shadow of CFR influence. Today, an elite handful of individuals define the agendas that are supported by the empire of establishment news.
What's up, YouTube? After this campaign against Viacom, I decided to look into the matter further And I've come to find that I've made a connection between the Council on Foreign Relations, the major media, and Viacom. Now, the Council on Foreign Relations is headed by David Rockefeller, who is a regular attendee of Bilderberg. Now, who knows what goes on in these discussions of Bilderberg? Some of us theorize that you know, they're discussing how they're going to continue with enslaving humanity. Now, what I'd like to discuss right now is the effect that Viacom will have buying out all these companies that are already owned by the Council on Foreign Relations. It makes me wonder, you know, how companies that are already bought by Council on Foreign Relations are being bought by Viacom. The only conclusion that I can come to is that the Council on Foreign Relations owns Viacom, a la now David Rockefeller owns Viacom. And now what really seems funny to me is now that Viacom wants to spread their influence to YouTube, one of the biggest forms of media we use to, you know, talk about what's going on in this world. If Viacom becomes involved with YouTube, you can most certainly expect that anyone who speaks out against the New World Order or exposes it is going to be banned, especially if what they're saying is true. So, you know, I saw another video stating that Viacom is Big Brother, and it really is. Viacom is now Big Brother, and, you know, to the average, video makers on YouTube who are just doing it for fun or whatever, what have you, you know, their hobby, or they make a series of shows or, you know, whatnot. I don't think they have too much to worry about. But most certainly you can start expecting truthers to be silenced off of YouTube when this happens. I fully expect to be silenced. And, you know, possibility is that, you know, Viacom can track down people who are speaking out against this globalist agenda and say that they were illegal downloading or uploading or whatever jail them, and that's a great way to silence people, permanently silence them. So you know, this Viacom thing is a very scary move, and I also wanted to touch a little bit on the connections that were made. You know, in one of the pictures, if you looked at the Nickelodeon picture and the picture of the pyramid right after that's on the back of the American $1 bill, that's the Illuminati all-seeing eye. Basically, they see everything. So I guess in order to close this, let's fight against this Viacom thing, and if all else fails, we can all just move to LiveLeak. All YouTube users, LiveLeak is out there. Come there if you want to hear the truth. Peace and God bless.